Natural erosion has always shaped the Earth's surface. However, human-induced erosion created by agriculture far exceeds geologic rates. Data published in early 2007 revealed that worldwide, humans cause erosion at a rate of 10 to 15 times faster than natural geologic processes, and estimated global erosion at 75 billion tons of soil per year. Each year, about 1.7 billion tons of soil wash or blow from farmlands of the United States. This quantity is equivalent to losing the full plow layer from 2 million acres of farmland. Most of the loss, almost a billion tons, results from water erosion. The remaining 0.7 billion tons is lost to wind erosion. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video, I'll discuss the consequences of erosion, the mechanics of water erosion, and predicting soil loss from it. Soil scientists follow the rule of thumb that 1 acre of land can afford to lose at most 1 to 5 tons of soil each year. The average soil loss to water erosion on cropland is thought to be about 3.8 tons per acre per year, close to the limit. Added to this amount, however, is an average soil loss of 2.5 tons per acre per year to wind erosion, as shown in the table on the left. These numbers actually reveal progress in combating erosion. Total erosion in 1982 was over 3 billion tons, and prior to that, conservation efforts that began in the 1930s, erosion was far worse than that. About 21% of American cultivated cropland suffers soil losses greater than the acceptable limit for water erosion. The figure on the right shows where water erosion takes place in the United States. The majority is concentrated in the eastern U.S. What damage is caused by this amount of erosion? Some of the damage occurs on a grower's fields. This is considered on-site damage. Some occurs elsewhere. This is off-site damage. Examples of on-site damage include these. Erosion removes topsoil. Topsoil affords the best root environment for providing the best structure, the most air, and an active population of organisms. Once topsoil is lost, only the less productive subsoil remains. Topsoil contains most of the soil's organic matter and plant nutrients. Erosion carries away nitrogen, phosphorus, and any nutrients stored mostly in organic matter. Large amounts of fertilizer paid for and applied by the grower are wasted. Erosion selectively removes organic matter and the finer soil particles responsible for cation exchange. Erosion thins the soil profile, decreasing the root zone. This is a particular problem on already shallow soils. Thinning topsoil and declining organic matter greatly reduces total plant available water in the root zone. This has been considered the most serious effect of erosion on productivity. It causes a decline in soil structure stability and increased compaction. Gullies cut up fields into odd-shaped pieces and make it very difficult to operate farm equipment. Examples of off-site problems include these. Eroded soil contains nutrients and pesticides that pollute lakes and streams. For instance, large fish kills have occurred in streams fed by runoff water from fields treated with soil insecticides. Soil particles entering bodies of water reduce water clarity, impairing habitat quality for aquatic organisms and recreational value. Soil washed away by erosion settles in streams, lakes, harbors, and reservoirs. The sediment fills in lakes and reservoirs, creating a need for expensive dredging. It reduces the ability of streams to carry water, resulting in an increase in flooding. On cultivated land, water erodes more soil than wind. Even in dry climates, occasional high-intensity storms can move a lot of soil off land, thinly protected by vegetation. Erosion follows 3 steps. First, the impact of raindrops shatters surface aggregates and loosens soil particles. Some of these particles float into soil voids, sealing the soil surface so that water cannot readily infiltrate the soil. Water ponds on the soil surface, then begins to move, flowing over the soil surface down any slope. The scoring action of running water also detaches some soil particles. Second, detached soil grains move in flowing water and are carried down slopes. As it flows down slope, water may collect in channels, increasing its erosive power. Finally, soil is deposited when the water slows down. These 3 steps are known as detachment, transport, and deposition. Detachment is the main task of raindrop impact, and transport primarily of flowing water, especially in channels. Erosion occurs when the precipitation rate exceeds soil infiltration rate. Water then ponds on the soil surface and is free to run downslope when there are no obstacles to overland flow. The erosive potential of a rainfall event is a function of rainfall volume and intensity. Volume is the total rainfall that lands in a single event, measured in total millimeters. Intensity is a measure of how fast rain falls, usually in units of millimeters per hour. The faster the rain falls and the larger the rain lasts, the greater will be the erosive potential of the rainfall and the greater will be the erosion. In many locations, most erosion occurs during occasional severe rainfall events. Texture has two effects on soil erosion. First, texture influences the infiltration rate of water. If rainwater infiltrates soil quickly, there's less ponding and less water runoff. Second, particles of different sizes vary in how easily they can be detached. Silt particles are most easily detached, so silty soils are liable to water erosion. Structure also influences infiltration. Good structural grades like granules reduce runoff. Compaction, loss of organic matter, and destruction of soil beds by tillage all reduce infiltration and increase the volume of water available to transport eroded soil. Slope has two components, length and grade. On a steep slope, water achieves a high runoff velocity, increasing its erosive energy. On a long slope, a greater surface area is collecting water, increasing flow volume. On a longer slope, running water can also pick up speed. The table shows that long, gentle slopes can have the same erosive potential as short, steep slopes. A rough soil surface impedes downhill flow of water, slowing its velocity. If roughness takes the form of ridges across a slope, water ponds behind the ridges, decreasing the volume of runoff water. However, if enough water collects behind a ridge, it overflows and wears it away. Thus, roughness can fail to stop erosion during very heavy rains on long slopes or if sealing of the soil surface stops infiltration. Surface roughness depends largely on tillage practices. The seedbed resulting from conventional tillage is smooth, while that from chisel plowing is rough. Tillage across slopes acts to impede downhill flow. Tillage up and down the slope promotes downhill flow. Bare soil is fully exposed to the erosive forces of raindrop impact and the scoring of running water. Soil cover reduces energy available to cause erosion. A mulch or cover of crop residues absorbs the energy of a falling raindrop, lessens detachment, and reduces sealing of the soil surface. Mulches also slow down runoff water. A complete crop cover, such as turf or hay, has the same effect. Plus, plant roots hold soil in place. Crops that are less close growing, such as row crops or nursery stock, have a different effect. As these crops close in between the rows, they form a canopy over the soil. This canopy intercepts rainfall and absorbs much of its impact. There are five types of water erosion. Splash erosion is the direct movement of soil by splashing. A soil grain can be thrown as far as 5 feet by raindrop splash. Sheet erosion is the removal of a thin layer of soil in a sheet. On gentle slopes or near the tops of steeper slopes, water moves in tiny streams too small to be noticed. This gives the impression of losing soil in a thin sheet. Sheet erosion appears in the background of the photo on top. Sheet erosion may go unnoticed until the subsoil appears. Rill erosion is visible as a series of many small channels on a slope. Water tends to collect in channels, picking up energy as it runs down the slope. As a result, running water carves out small but visible channels called rills. A rill is small enough to be filled in by tillage. The bottom photo shows rill erosion in the background. Ephemeral gullies are large rills. The channel is small enough that tillage equipment can cross it and largely, but not completely, fill it in by tillage. During another heavy rainfall, water will collect in the old channel and erosion will begin there. Each rain will wash away any soil thrown into the ephemeral gully by tillage, so soil from a wider area will be lost. The foreground of the bottom photo shows an ephemeral gully. Gully erosion is the most highly visible erosion. Gullies are so large that equipment cannot cross them. Bottom left photo. Using the soil loss factors described, an equation has been developed to predict the average soil loss from sheet and rill erosion on a specific site called the Revised Universal Soil Loss Equation, RUSEL. The equation predicts sheet and rill erosion only. The equation predicts average soil loss over time. At the heart of the rule is the assumption that a certain soil loss can be tolerated because soil-forming processes replace lost soil. In virgin grasslands, erosion may amount to an inch every 5,000 years, or about 3 pounds of acre per year. In the Palouse area of the Pacific Northwest, erosion levels sometimes reach 50 to 100 tons per acre per year. Soil scientists have decided that soil losses between 1 ton and 5 tons per acre per year can be tolerated, depending on quality and depth of a soil. The amount that can be tolerated is symbolized by the letter T. Each soil series has its own value of T, which is noted on Webb's Soil Survey. However, T certainly exceeds normal soil formation rates. That is, even at T, soil is being lost more rapidly than it is being replaced. So many soil scientists maintain that T is not a sustainable loss over the long term and not a reliable guide to the need of erosion control measures. The equation for Russell is as follows. A equals R times K times LS times C times P. A is the tons of soil loss per acre per year. Obviously, A should be less than T. R is the rainfall and runoff factor. R is based on the total erosive powers of storms during an average year. R depends on local weather conditions. The isoerodent map in the top figure shows R values for the United States. K is the soil erodibility factor. K depends on texture, structure, and organic matter content. Webb's Soil Survey gives the value of K for mapped soils. LS is the slope factor. L compares the slope length and S compares grade with the standard plot. L and S are separate factors, but they can be treated as one variable. LS. LS values can be determined from the bottom chart. C is the crop and management factor. C compares cropping practices, residue management, and soil cover to the standard clean fallow plot. C values are calculated from detailed tables and are valid only within the area for which they are calculated. Natural Resources Conservation Service, NRCS, offices prepare simplified tables for use in the field, and some have computerized the computations. The table shows crop management factors for southern Minnesota. P is for support practice factor. P compares the effect of contour tillage and contour strip cropping with the test plot. Let us try a sample solution for a field with the following characteristics. Assume that we measure a slope of 55% that is 100 feet long. According to the soil survey for this area, T equals 5.0. Assume the grower uses conventional tillage to grow continuous corn and plows up and down the slope in the fall. The farm is in east central Minnesota. The county is shaded on the isoerodent map. We begin with the formula A equals R times K times LS times C times P. The value of R is read from the isoerodent map. In this case, R equals 135. The value of K is given in the soil survey report. For this soil, K is 0.18. The value of LS can be obtained from the LS chart. Find the slope length on the bottom axis, 100, and follow up the chart until it touches the 5% slope line. Follow the dotted line already drawn in the chart. The LS factor is shown as LS equals 0.6. Therefore, A equals 135 times 0.18 times 0.6 C times P, which equals 14.58 CP. Refer to the chart to find the C value under conventional fall plowing in continuous corn. C equals 0.37. The farmer used no support practices, so P equals 1, meaning it is the same as in the test plot. A equals 14.58 times 0.37 times 1, which equals 5.39 tons per acre per year. The computed soil loss is slightly greater than the acceptable level for the soil. However, since the equation, if anything, understates losses, the farmer should curtail some of the erosion. What practices will lower the erosion level? What if the farmer changes to contour plowing rather than up and down plowing? For contour plowing, P changes from 1.0 to 0.5. The other factors remain the same. Now A equals 2.7 tons per acre per year. The equation says that changing to contour tillage will cut erosion in half, well below the 5 tons per acre. Changing from mold bore plowing to contour chisel plowing, leaving a 30% cover, would save even more soil. C would equal 0.19 and A would equal 1.39 tons per acre per year. The most obvious way to use the Russell is to predict erosion from a certain field and to help select the best control measures. The example showed how this can be done. In conclusion, hopefully you learned more about water erosion and how you can calculate water erosion from a field so that you can ensure that erosion is minimized and appropriate strategies are implemented. In the next video, you'll learn about specific strategies to use.